You guys, Jeff and I were just talking about that. Like when I was in your shoes, to make a little short film, you needed a camera, film, developing, cutting it, then printing it. It's so much more fun now. It's so quick and easy.
So everyone got to introduce themselves to John? Good. Very informal. This is the 20th Annual Film Festival Group that will be presenting their films on June 5th. So, in a moment, we're going to start the introduction. And John, just for archive's sake, Sebastian Rothwin, who has a wonderful voice, everyone here has a wonderful voice, is going to read your bio. Come on up.
Yeah,
you're going to see
right
Tony's
here.
Voice.
Oh, my God. I would have made it a lot shorter, that old thing.
It's only take him out. He's very cute. He'll do it in a
minute. Do it
he
fast.
Studied it this morning.
It took me like 2 hours to make this all up.
So, Sebastian, when you're ready, you're going to look right down the barrel of the lens, introduce
okay.
yourself,
yes.
and we're going to read along with you. Fernando, are we rolling?
Yeah, rolling.
Okay, so look right down the barrel of the lens. Introduce yourself. Nice and loud.
I'm Sebastian Rothwin, and I'd like to say welcome to John David Coles.
Thank you.
John Coles is an award-winning director and producer known for evocative material with compelling performances from some of today's most respected actors. He has enjoyed success in features, television, and theater, while his production company, Talking Wall Pictures, has focused on the development of cutting-edge feature and television projects. Coles shot his first full-length 16mm film at 17, a riot update of Casablanca, reimagined in a high school. While at Amherst College, he directed a documentary about the school that was aired on PBS, and soon after was making short films for Saturday Night Live. He then went on to become an editor on Francis Coppola's Rumblefish and The Cotton Club. His feature directorial debut, Signs of Life, starred Beau Bridges, Vincent D'Onofrio, and Mary Louise Parker. The film won the International Critics Prize at Deauville and launched a prolific and versatile directing career. Other long-form credits include Rising Sun with Matt Damon and Brian Dennehy, Darrow with Kevin Spacey, and The Good Fight with Christine Latty. In the world of television, Coles distinguished himself as one of the few directors who is equally adept at both drama and comedy. He has directed numerous Emmy Award-winning series ranging from Sex and the City to The West Wing, and many other notable shows such as Desperate Housewives, Grey's Anatomy, and Damages. Coles is currently directing the Netflix phenomenon House of Cards, starring Kevin Spacey and produced by David Fincher. His success as an episodic director allowed John to begin a producing career, and one of his first projects, Thief, led to Andre Bauer's Emmy Award for Best Actor. Other executive credits include hit drama Elementary, Unforgettable, Law & Order Criminal Intent with Jeff Goldblum, 3 Pounds with Stanley Tucci, New Amsterdam, and the drama Wonderland, a critically acclaimed series that addressed the frail boundaries of insanity within a New York City hospital's psychiatric ward. Coles continues to write and create original dramas through Talking Wall Pictures, which produced the CBS drama Songs in Ordinary Time, based on the Oprah Winfrey Book Club pick, starring Sissy Spacek and Beau Bridges, and co-created and executive produced the series Crash and Burn. Talking Wall has developed numerous projects with HBO, CBS, New Line, IFC, Bravo, and worked with numerous distinguished writers, including Academy Award nominee Mike Weller from Hair, Pulitzer Prize winner Doug Wright from Quills, Kate Robin from 6 Feet Under, and Anne Peacock, Knights in Rodanthe. In the theater world, Coles was a member of the Circle Rep Lab and an alumnus of Wynn Handman at the American Place Theater. His off-Broadway credits include directing the critically acclaimed play The Impostor, starring Austin Pendleton and Calista Flockhart, as well as Johnny Suede, starring Tom DiCillo. Coles lives in New York with his wife, Laura, and his kids, Sam and Jessica. He is a Sundance Directors Lab alumni and teaches at the Columbia University Graduate Film Program.
Round of applause.
That was long. I want to shorten it up for you.
Thank you, Sebastian. Okay, so this is how the afternoon is going to play out. I know many of you have looked at John's IMDb page and you have questions regarding some of his projects, and we'll take time to do that at the end of the lecture. But in the beginning, we want to show you some of John's work.
we have some questions that John and I prepared that we want to talk about, and then we're going to open it up. Those of you that want to volunteer will take the director seat. You'll give the elevator pitch, not your tagline, to John, and you'll show your one scene that you're working on for the film festival, not your entire film. We only have it till 4. Some of you have classes. We probably will be joined throughout the next 2 hours by some CMT 10 students and editing students. But for now, this is it. And it's very complimentary that it's a small group, because each of you will get a chance to pitch your film. If we had a larger group like we had the other day, this wouldn't happen. So, without further ado, John, would it be all right if we just ran your 3-minute reel?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, sure. So we're going to run John's 3-minute reel, and then we'll begin the Q&A. Everybody sit up real close. Nobody sit in the back. Back seats are for the deans that come in late because they have many, many meetings to attend about the wonderful construction going on this campus. Okay.
We are animals, man, woman, walking the earth. We're made of head, heart, and loins. We're talking about using them. Am I right?
Well.
Happiness hit her like a train on a track. Coming towards her, stuck still, no turning back. She hit her.
You ready to saddle up?
Out of here.
brings back a lot of memories.
You know, many of you will be doing a demo reel shortly. Some of you already have one. You know, it might be a bad idea to segue into this. John, when you prepare a demo reel like this, do you have just one demo reel, or do you keep special demo reels for special jobs that you want the producers or writers to see?
You know, to be honest with you, it's one of my least favorite things in the world because, you know, looking at your own material and then deciding what's good and what's really good is a very hard thing to do, and then putting it together. So I tried a bunch of different demo reels and wasn't really very happy or very successful, and actually ultimately gave like 6 or 7 of the movies and TV shows to someone I never even met and said, show me something. That's pretty much what he came up with. And it was great because it was like a fresh, someone with fresh eyes who just was like running the movies just for like, you know, I gave him certain parameters, like, you know, because I got to show some famous actors, you got to have some action, you got to have some, you know, whatever. And he just, you know, was zipping through the various movies and just pulling things out and putting together. I picked the music, you know, we picked Florence and the Machine and something else. And it was like a very unlike intellectual process. It was a very just sort of kind of emotional and sort of spontaneous process. You know, it's interesting. I'm in the midst of doing a website for myself and my company. And it's, again, it's the same thing, like how do you articulate, you know, something like this, you know, is that long and helpful or is that pretentious and boring? You know what I mean? It's like you don't know. Mm-hmm. And so you just take a shot at it and then you figure, okay, if it doesn't work, we'll change it. It's like everything else.
And you can see from the other guests that you've met this semester, everyone has a different approach to showing you their work. Sometimes, you know, they have pieces of their work and little bullets, and they share it with you as you discuss their work, and it just happens to be there. So it's a very organic process sometimes, and sometimes it's not. So we want to talk about Elementary, because you have many Elementary fans in the class. And when we were looking at your IMDb bio, we saw executive producer, and then we saw that you were directing episodes. And many of our students asked the same question. How does that happen? How do you get involved in directing something you produce? And I thought you can shed some light on how that process works.
Well, it's a really great question. And the best way to describe it is that in television, unlike films, television tends to be driven initially by the idea that is the series. Like in Elementary, it's let's redo the Sherlock Holmes story, but with a man and a woman, and he'll have come from London, and he was addicted to drugs, and he's trying to go straight, and she's his sober companion. You know, that was the concept, that was the pitch, right? And the, okay, and then we'll have the various crimes each week, and so on and so forth. And so there's this guy, Rob Doherty, who's very talented in Los Angeles, who essentially took that, pitched it to the networks, and then wrote the pilot. And then they did a pilot, which got picked up to, you know, to series last year at this time. And so he is first and foremost a writer, and he also has the weight of having to come up with a new script that's an hour long every 8 days, because it takes about 8 days to film an episode. Unless things don't go well, then maybe it takes a 9th day. But for the most part, it's supposed to take 8 days. So, you know, as you can imagine, you guys have some experience in writing scripts and doing production and so on. To come up with a good script every 8 days, even with the staff of people, it's incredibly difficult. And, you know, and if you're going to do a whole, you know, series of, you know, 24 episodes, you got to assume that there'll be like, you know, 10 good ones, 10 three great ones, 3 not so great ones, and a couple of dogs. You know, it's the way it's going to be. But him and his writing staff and the urgencies of trying to get is a very time-consuming thing. On top of which, there's post-production, and that's also very time-consuming stuff. So you have those two things, and you have a guy who's created the show who basically comes from a writing background, and he is the executive producer of the show. But then you have what's going on. He's in Los Angeles. Then you have what's going on in New York, which is we're finding locations, we're casting the show, we're shooting the show each week. You know, we're dealing with building sets, all the stuff that goes into production. And because every director has to prep the show and then shoot it and then cut it, no director could do any more than one every three or four episodes. So directors are coming and going on the show. So the appetite has arisen over the last number of years, especially if shows have moved out of Los Angeles, to have someone in the position who's kind of like the kind of artistic director or sort of the artistic consistency in a show, so that the writer's back in Los Angeles, he can know that there's someone in New York, in the case of Elementary, who's keeping an eye on what is sort of the larger artistic, you know, prerogatives of the show. So what's happened is they reach to directors, you know, which makes a lot of sense, and say, okay, come in and help us, you know, keep the train on the tracks and sort of keep the artistic consistency of this show. So from my point of view, you know, having done some movies and having done some television, as a television director, you tend to come into a show, like whether it's Sex and the City or Damages or any one of a number of shows, you know, you'll come in, you'll do your little piece, and then you're out again. So you don't really have a sense of like you're part of that family. But being the executive producer who has this sort of ongoing artistic responsibility, it allows you to stay with the show. Like I stayed with that show, we've done 24 episodes now. So I'm, you know, it started last May and finished a week ago. And so it's this long, you know, much deeper association, both in terms of your relationship to the cast, your relationship to the writing process, the cutting, and so on and so forth. So that's sort of where that evolves out of, and that's sort of what the, you know, what they call the producing director slash executive producer job is. And specifically the job is, you know, you get the script, you may have some issues artistically with the script in terms of the story. You also look at the script in terms of its producibility. So, for example, it might be too long, or it might have too many locations, or it might have too much cast, or it might be not long enough, or whatever it is. So supposedly you're looking at it from a production point of view, production slash creative point of view. You're then right away thrown into the world of finding locations, because, you know, with these shows, as you can see, you might shoot some scenes on the standing set, like Elementary, everybody knows there's the brownstone and there's a police station, but then you're out on locations all the time. So you gotta find those locations. Remember, the prep is 8 days as well. So, you know, hopefully by day one or day two, you're well into seeing locations, working with location department. Then there's the casting. You know, an episode might have as many as 10 or 12 parts that you've got to cast in the course of that time. And it's got to be cast quickly because those parts, once they're cast, have to go to be wardrobed and makeup and all that kind of stuff and sizes, and they have to go shopping for them. So it can't all wait till the last minute. So in that position, you're overseeing, you know, the script, the incoming director, overseeing him going through the casting. And then you'll actually sit down once, you know, the locations, the sets that you're going to build for that show and the casting is done, then you'll actually start to have meetings about things like, you know, it's got to snow, so you got to meet with the special defects department. There's explosions, there's shootout. It's always something. And believe me, that 7 or 8 days goes by before you know it, because by day five, you're on what's called a tech scout, which is you get the whole crew and you go to all the locations, you talk about what you're going to do. And day six or seven, the day before you shoot, usually you'll have a read through and you'll have a discussion with the director and the writer back in Los Angeles to talk about the tone of the piece. So really that 7 day prep turns into like 5 days. So it's, and sometimes the directors can be a little overwhelmed because they're coming into a big situation. So I'm there kind of as a backstop as well. And then if there are issues in terms of an actor, you know, has an issue with a particular scene, some dialogue or something like that, there's someone in New York who can go down to the set and say, do it. Or, what do you want to do? Oh, that's a much better idea. Or whatever it is, however you sort of work that out. And then there are also issues that come up on the set, like, you know, obviously time is always a big issue when you're filming, as you guys already know. So, you know, you sit down with the director and you say, okay, you know, we had to shoot 3 scenes today. You've shot 2 of them. We now have an hour left of a 14-hour day. What are you going to do? And so then you talk about how you could, you know, and I ideally you have that conversation before the day starts. You talk about where you're going to put your emphases and where you're going to spend your time and where you're going to go quickly and how you're going to make this all work, and you'll do like a little timetable. So those are the kinds of things that, So, in a sense, it's a producer, but it's not the producer in the sense that I'm not the producer that's going out and selling the project, and I'm not the producer, and raising the money, and I'm not the producer who's what we call a line producer, who's in charge of all the nickels and dimes and making sure that the crew's hired and the lunch is hot and all that kind of stuff. It's sort of like a creative producer, if you will, an artistic director. It's sort of the best way I can describe it.
So if I can ask the first question for our students, how is it working with Lucy Liu?
She's wonderful. Lucy's terrific. I mean, she's a great person. She's really smart. I think, just between us, I think there were some expectations in terms of, what her role, the expanse of her role would be on the show, because it really is kind of the Johnny Lee Miller show. And I think she quickly realized that the dynamic was what it was going to be and said, that's cool, and has sort of gone with it. The chemistry between the two of them, is really marvelous. And I did the very first episode, and, the first scene, the first day, the first episode, the chemistry was there. And, that's something that, it's like when you cast, it's rolling the dice. You hope it's there. And if it's not, it's very hard to manufacture.
And that's the second question, rolling the dice. Because many of our students, and as I mentioned to you earlier, they're working with first-time actors. They're going to NYU Film School. They're going to theater workshops. They're really dealing with real actors. Could you talk a little bit about, since they're all still in production, about the relationship between the first-time director and professional actors?
Well, I would say my rule of thumb is, unless there's a problem, stay out of the way. and I say that, I'm sure that, you would hear that from very many, well-renowned, from Oliver Stone, from, any one of a number of directors, that actors, I think, come in usually with pretty good ideas. I think your job is to cast them correctly so they're not, so they're suited for the part, they have a feeling for the part, you like them in the part, they like. And so I think as a young director, when I first started out, and I did a fair amount of theater stuff and went to acting and directing classes and understood the mechanics of acting, and it really is, there are mechanics to acting, and if you don't know about those mechanics, you should learn about them if you want to be a director. What is the technique of acting, and how do you adjust a performance using those technical things that are available to you, no different than how you would just f-stop or focus or whatnot, no different, but parallel to that. And I think that the less said, the better. I mean, when I was a young director, I used to go in and I would be like, okay, here's my big idea, and this is what I think the scene is about, and this and that. Now I try to say as little as possible, and if it works, great. If it's not, I will try to make whatever adjustments that I can to try to make it, work without always encouraging the actor, always having a very positive attitude towards the actor, and sort of, taking what they have and sort of moving it forward in the right direction. If you have someone who's just, for whatever reasons, you pick the wrong person and it's not working, I remember there's sort of an old saying that has, like, as a young director, you think you can get anything out of anybody, and that's not always the case. Sometimes it's just, it can't be. Then you find ways, shoot it from far away, or you make them talk real fast, or, you get through the moment and you deal with it in the cutting room. And that's, I can't say that it doesn't happen all the time, because it does. And you'd be surprised what you can do in the cutting room and how, whatever the script is in terms of the blueprint, what the actors do with that script later on is your new script. And you should forget about what you initially conceived and deal with what you have now. It's one of the biggest mistakes that people do, is they try to look through the footage to the script that used to be there and try to say, well, it's not what I had in mind. How can I bend it to make it more like what I had in mind? Forget about what you had in mind and just let that footage speak to you, and then, let it evolve.
And that's, that's a good segue, because the editing room, many of you in this class are in your advanced editing class. Now we have Video 1 Final Cut class, and then a Video 2 Avid Editing class. And many of them are not editing their films. They actually separate themselves from the editing room and give it to another editor. They're just too close to the project and they can't be objective. Could you talk, John, about from the editing room to the director's chair, how did the assistant editing work that you began with when I met you, when you were working on Four Friends and Cotton Club? how did it prepare you for directing, and what tips can you give these young editor directors on how they can use that wonderful experience they're having now learning how to be editors while they're directing?
Well, I think I've already sort of said, I think the most salient thing, which is that, you know, when you go into the cutting room, don't go in with a script in your hand. Let it go, and then deal with the footage as it comes to you. I also think, you know, when I worked on those films, I was lucky because I got a job, you know, working for some pretty well-known directors, you know, Arthur Penn and Francis Coppola and whatever. And that's when we met. And I have to say, it's, if there's one thing that really was helpful was I saw those guys like blind men staggering through the darkness. And that was really great because it demystified the whole process. Like, if Francis Coppola was in that scene, he didn't know what to do. Well, then I could do that too. I could get as lost just like he got lost. So it wasn't like these were magicians who were on some other level. They were dealing with the fact.
You saw them in the room with Barry Malkin, right?
All the time. I mean, you know, a year. I spent a year on each one of those films. So we were together a lot. And you saw them, and you saw the evolution of those films from the script. You know, we saw the, you know, the screen test for the actors, and then we saw the dailies on, you know, every day for months at a time, and then we saw the first cuts. I mean, on Four Friends, the first one I worked on, which was an Arthur Penn film. Arthur Penn was a wonderful Broadway and film director who did things like Alice's Restaurant and Bonnie and Clyde and whatnot. And The Miracle Worker. I mean, just wonderful, wonderful films. And, you know, that film, the first edit of that film was about 4 hours and 15 minutes long. And the final film was a little under 2 hours. And, you know, to watch that journey was a very interesting journey about choices that were made, about trying to decide what in the footage was important and what you could let go of from the script, those kinds of things. So that was an interesting process, and there's a technical side to it as well. I mean, you know, it's so different. You know, back in those days, you had 35 millimeter film and you had a moviola. I don't know if you guys even know what a moviola is.
Yeah,
flatbed moviola. Yeah, flatbeds. The guys that I worked with were a generation older than I am now, so it's like, they're like my age now. Back then, 25 years ago, so they didn't even they had Steenbecks, but for day-to-day cutting, they used a thing called a moviola, where you'd slap open the sound and you'd slap open the picture. You put in the film and then you close it. You'd hold it and feed it and watch it. But, you know, that piece of film, that 35 millimeter piece of film that you were cutting, you know, that take, because the film would get all broken down into takes, was then going to be cut and made into a work print, you know, that you'd be cutting with. And that would be used for screenings and previews and everything for like a year. So, you know, you didn't want to chew it all up because it wasn't like another one that was going to come. So there was a lot of thought that went into each and every cut. It was kind of the opposite process. If you can imagine, you know, you sit down and you write a 10-page paper, and you're gonna write it on a typewriter, and every time you type out a page and you wanna change something, you have to type the whole page again. Well, you know, that's like a completely different dynamic than when you're working like we all do on a computer now, where you just go back and you change something. So if you know you're gonna have to retype the page at the end of that process, you're going to think really carefully before you start to write. So editing in those days had a lot more of this sort of the conceptualizing that happened before you actually made the first cut. I remember when Barry Malkin, Blackie Malkin, you know, I'd see him go back and forth, and I'd be sitting there holding the film for him, and back and forth and back and forth, and finally he'd mark it, and then he'd go back and forth, and then he'd erase the mark. But then I understood that he was like processing what was going on. And I think what it taught me was to conceptualize what I was doing, as opposed to what is very easy to do now when you're working with Final Cut or the Avid or something like that, which is, yeah, just throw something together and then start to make sense out of it later on, which is a legitimate process as well. But it was very different than what we used to do back in those days. It's also a great place, you know, the editing room is a great place to really learn, you know, essentially pace, performance, what's possible. I mean, you know, you guys have been through it a little bit now. You know you can completely transform those things. You know, how to tell a story, how you can jump forward, how the audience will go with you, how you can change your performance by focusing on one person, not the other person, or taking a few lines out, or putting the end of the scene at the beginning. I mean, there's all kinds of things that you can try to do. And, you know, having spent, you know, that was a 3 or 4 year period of my life where I was watching these films evolve, and they did evolve, you know, very dramatically. And then last, and I'll move on, is that, you know, one of the things that was really astonishing about the process was that, you know, these were huge films, that Cotton Club was probably the most expensive film of its day. And so a lot of resources were expended in the making of that film, and there are a lot of good stories too. But, you know, Coppola was unbelievable in that if he was watching his film and there was a sequence, say a huge song and dance number that took 2 weeks to shoot, and he felt it wasn't working or wasn't working in the context of the film, he'd throw it away. And that fluidity and that sort of willingness to sort of look at the bigger picture instead of falling in love with all the small ones is a very important thing. And it's, you know, it's a lesson I've learned a million times.
And that's something you all should start thinking about the next 3 weeks, because there are scenes that you thought would work and they don't. And if it doesn't move the story forward, Francis Coppola can do it, and the gentleman he's talking about also grew up in the Bronx. Mm-hmm. Barry Malkin can do it, who's one of the editors on Godfather 2. You can do it. Mm-hmm. They fall in love with scenes that have nothing to do with moving their movie forward. It just looks well, it's the right time of day, the actors walking down the street have some sort of presence, but it doesn't help your story. Want to take a complete 360-degree turn, because we're going to look at some clips. John and I, when I emailed John for his schedule, I told him I was going to vote for him for the DGA Executive Board office, and one of my students asked me recently, there's a coffee cup on my desk, when should they join a union? In particular, the Directors Guild, or the Editors Guild, or the Cinematographers Guild. When is the right time, John, with all the people you've met in the industry in both television and film, is there a right time?
It's actually a very simple answer, which is when someone offers you a job that you really want, that requires you to join the union, join. There's no reason to join before that. Just none whatsoever.
Tell me the downside, what happens if they join?
Well, I did it. What happened with me was, you know, I was working in editing, and then I made a short film, and then someone saw the short film and offered me a chance to direct some the little short. We used to make short films to Saturday Night Live. I don't know if they still do it.
Who watches Saturday Night Live these days?
And nobody does. Yeah, whatever. But anyway, they're short films. And so I said, yeah, I'd love to do it. And they said, well, you have to join the union. And I was like 24, 25, and I was like, okay. And, you know, the DGA is a very good union. It's, you know, they were able, you know, it costs you a lot of money to join the union, but you can pay it out over 10 years if you want, whatever it was. So I was like, oh, fine, I'll join the union. I did those shorts for Saturday Night Live, and then the season ended, and then other people came in, and I wasn't going to work on it anymore. Now I was in the union, which meant that all the other jobs that I could get, which were non-union jobs, I couldn't do. So that's the downside of being in the union, which is if you want to work in a non-union environment, which you probably will work in until you get to a certain level, being in the union can really be a drag.
You got to be ready for it. And good luck. I'm voting for you. We're going to look at a clip, John.
Let me move my chair around, yeah, because it was hard to see.
And then we're going to discuss the clip. So can we see the menu, Fernando? The menu on John's reel?
Oh, you want to look at my clips or their clips?
You're looking at John's reel. I'm sorry.
No, let's look at their clips.
Okay,
You've seen enough of my stuff.
Let's hold John's work back to the end. I wanted to show them. If we have time, we'll look at one or two of John's clips. Who's the first person going up? Who's ready?
Yes.
Okay, Sebastian. Sebastian, you got to do your pitch first.
Okay. See right here?
Yeah, absolutely. Come over here and join us.
Yep. All right. Yes. Okay, I guess I could just read off here. Yes, I'm Sebastian. My film is called Double Agent. It's about an elite spy who goes undercover to stop an arms dealer from trading a dangerous weapons trigger. Things do not go according to plan, and then he finds out just how secret his secret agency really is. So we're going to see the first minute where the first set of effects come in, and then we can cut it right there. If that's okay, because I'm still working on those. So, all right. Just rewind, please. Yeah, thank you. Rewind, thank you. Let's play the first minute.
Okay.
You mind moving that out of the way, please?
Agent X, you will be inserted into the offices of Hanson Wazotsky, the financial services firm.
Επενδύσεις στο επαγγελματικό τομέα των οποίων οι ΑΕΟ έχουν δείξει τάσεις μεγάλων αποδοχών μέχρι στιγμής. Αναμένουμε σταθερή ανάπτυξη μόλις το τουρκικό Υπουργείο ανακοινώσει την κατοχή των παραχωνισίδων με το νέο έτος. Φυσικά. Ευχαριστώ.
Her name, we believe, is Giselle Taylor. We do know her bodyguard, and if she needs him, then you will be able to handle this with ease. Your objectives are these. All of the data relating to the Arcturus HD 85512 Bravo. It will look like a simple system failure until the backup fails to restore. Once this occurs, the QRF will be dispatched.
Okay. Class, you've seen this work in progress. Any comments, suggestions for Sebastian before he locks himself in the editing room tonight? You had a comment, Lee.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yes.
I like it.
I love the walking comments.
I thought it was well edited.
Well edited, okay.
Yeah, I actually saw him in the in the room. I got a pre-screening.
Okay.
Yeah, like I've actually been seeing him work on the actual graphics for it. It's really coming together really nicely.
Yeah, I was going to touch on that. It's impressive to see what you're doing with the graphics, having seen it raw. It's impressive.
And John, something I wanted to bring up, maybe you could shed some light on this. He is at, Sebastian's actually doing the special effects and the editing himself. He's doing it all. Is it hard in your case sometimes to separate yourself when there is special, even long credits or any type of special effects in audio or picture? I mean, is this something we can leave Sebastian with so he doesn't have too much?
Well, let me ask you where you are in the I mean, have you finished sort of a cut of the film and now you're going back and putting in the effects?
Yes. Yes. The first thing was the cut, you know, no sound, no nothing at first.
Right.
I just did that because I needed it to make sense visually.
Right.
You know, speed this up, slow it down, do this, do that. You know.
Now, is someone going to do a score for this or is there music?
Yes,
or someone's going to do a score?
Well, after the visual cut, then I added just the sound, just the voices, I should say, just the voices of the primary cast. I still have to add the sound effects, still have to add the score, and all the other small items, but right now I'm just doing the visual effects because I have to add the sound effect for those as well. So I figured, let me just do that before adding the sound effects, then having to go back, add the effects, and then add the sound effects for
gotcha.
The visual effects.
How about your picture? Are you in the 5 to 6 minute length yet? What's
yes, it's about 4 minutes and 57 seconds.
Yeah,
right
the cutoff of the film film is 5 minutes. It can't be 5 minutes, 10 seconds. It can be 4 minutes and 50 seconds, but not 5 minutes, 10 seconds.
Yeah. Well,
well, it's a very, it's beautifully done. It's very elegant and, you know, quite visually striking. And are the transitional effects that you're using something that you'll use throughout the piece?
Yes, there is some measure of consistency to those. If there's, like when there's movement, like going upstairs and so on, that's when that is used. It's only used when those things occur, though. So if someone's just walking by, then it's the same kind of effect for people walking by. I try not to change it. The only transition that does change is instead of dissolve when things happen, once the graphics come in, then it's a technical, it looks technical as it dissolves. Like it's almost like, I don't know how to describe it without you actually seeing it, but it takes that kind of turn where the visual effects have to match the, you know, the introduction of the, you know, the holograms,
right.
Because the whole film becomes, you know, it goes along a certain...
Right,
yeah,
I understand. That's sort of a prelude to what's to come.
Right,
and
it ends on that same way. So, you know,
Well, it looks like you're on your way, that's for sure.
Cool, thank you.
Okay, who's next? Who would like to show their clip next? Do we have a volunteer?
Yeah.
We do? Notice that not too many volunteers today. Is it because it's a rainy day?
I'll go.
Okay. Kiana, take this director's chair. Introduce yourself to John.
Hello, I'm Kiana Johnson.
Right. Okay.
My 5-minute film was a documentary based on this light-skinned versus dark-skinned people controversy. Like, I tried not to focus racially between, you know, the black and whites, but mainly people of the same race competing to see who's better. Mm-hmm. And, you know, ask questions such, you know, to find out how it is affecting children, you know, and yeah, basically that's it.
Cool.
And here, that's just a few clips of interviews.
Let's roll the tape.
Me personally, I wouldn't say, per se, that I was affected by being, you know, a woman of color. However, you know, I have seen instances in the media, women of color, comparisons being made between a light-skinned woman of color and a darker or brown-skinned woman of color. And it causes a certain type of separation. Thank God, me personally, I never had, you know, a complex or felt like I was inferior because of me being a woman of color, you know.
The media portrays dark-skinned people to be the wrong complexion. And in the media, they have commercials showing light-skinned females.
You also hear about, like, when it comes out, because I've heard it personally, walking down the street, people that I know, they see me, oh, you're really pretty, and oh, you're pretty for a dark-skinned girl. So, like, as a dark-skinned girl, am I supposed to be ugly? Like, I don't understand. I don't get why that phrase is used so much, as if you're dark-skinned or you have darker skin, you're just automatically supposed to be ugly, and if you have light skin, you're supposed to be so beautiful.
I did hear something before on the internet about a female who was actually a model, and she was attending a video casting, and a certain artist, a known artist, made some kind of comment in regards to the color of her skin. I really feel that that's ignorant, because you are a person of color. You are how God made you and how God intended you to be. There's no mistake on the color of your skin. If you're light skin, that's how your creator wanted you to be. If you're dark skin, that's how your creator wanted you to be. And for, you know, any females or any girls out there who's going through, you know, a self-esteem issue or have any type of complex, you just have to accept yourself for who you are and to love yourself, because beauty is in the eye of the beholder. And you have to know that dark is beautiful. If I'm dark, I love it. And it doesn't matter what anybody else says to you, as long as you love yourself and accept yourself. You can't let your family members break you down. You can't let your friends break you down. You can't let the media break you down. If you watch music videos, magazines, if you read a newspaper, no matter what anyone says, because at the end of the day, that is only their opinion.
The right skin is your skin, your individual skin. It shouldn't matter if it's lighter or darker. When it concerns chicken, it should matter. Or when you're eating. To me, I feel that every person has their make, model, shape, form, year. It's all for a purpose. So long as you serve your purpose, your skin tone, color shouldn't matter. It's only a vehicle.
It doesn't matter what complexion you are, light skin, dark skin. It really matters what's inside.
Comments,
objections, Latiana. She's still editing. She's still shooting. This is your moment.
Good
yes.
work.
Ariel?
How many more people are you interviewing?
Well, I have this more than that. I interviewed about maybe 10 people now. And I'm going to get a few more people, you know, just to figure out what I want to put, basically. Like, I'm still shooting right now.
Ian? Yeah. Do you have any young...
That's my next thing. I'm trying to do that this week, shoot some children.
Are those young men and women going to be interviewed in the studio or on location in the box?
You know well, yet? I was going to use, like, a school. I was talking to my editor about getting her son's school. We're going to try to use the classroom and do that.
John, in terms of her camera, any suggestions? Because she's still shooting. She's going on location.
I think it looks great. I think it's exactly as it should be. And I guess my big question for you is, have you found that in doing these interviews and starting to edit them together, have you found that your impressions and your thoughts about the subject have evolved?
Yeah, basically. Like, I mean, it was things on the... that I've never heard before, you know. I mean, with other interviews that's not shown there, I heard stories that, you know, just expanded my idea even more. It was like, you know, things that you know, people gone through. And then my original idea was just to focus mainly on the children aspect and how, you know, it's affecting them. But then I found that what people were saying made it more powerful, and it, you know, just changed as I went on.
And I'm sure that as you go forward, it'll be, you know, very difficult to sort of find those 5 minutes.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Given all the material that you already have, I'm sure that's going to be a challenge.
Who's shooting with you on location? Raise your hand if you're going to be one of the camera people shooting with Kiana. No one in this class? You know, my big concern is, yes, you're going to be shooting?
So.
You have a 5 minute. Please make sure that there's some variety of shots. I mean, you were fairly far away. When you got closer, these are beautiful people. I want to see them. I want to see them swallow, you know, and I want to see their veins in their neck. I want to see them in their Adam's apple move. I mean, they're humans. I want to see their shoulders move. They're so far away, I feel like I want to touch them, but I can't get close.
The way it was edited, I mean, like this part, it's a lot of closer shots. Like,
Do you go in?
So it's just this, you know.
Did you ever think about shooting them with two cameras?
Yeah, but I mean, I was just in the studio and I just used what was, you know, right there and there.
That's sometimes an effective way of doing it because, you know, you can't get those moments back.
Yeah.
If you were in tight with one camera long, you could go with what you want. You know? But you have great camera people to work with. Mm-hmm. They know when to zoom in. Just kidding. Okay, this is great. So you're on your way. Good luck. Round of applause. Many of the students have had a lot of problems with crew and with actors and locations, and you know, we basically gave Kiana the kitchen sink, and she's taking advantage of it because all the students have the option to shoot on campus and take advantage of the facilities and the crew members that will be made available for you by shooting on campus. But then again, you're in a great borough like the Bronx, and you should be shooting on location as much as you can. Who's next? Edgar. Edgar, someone's gonna have to run your video because you gotta come up here and pitch your movie. Darlene's coming up. Come on. Darlene, introduce yourself to John.
Hey, how are you?
Nice
my name is Darlene Vanders. My movie is basically about this guy. He's been in a relationship with a female for like a couple of years now. He's going to a therapist and he finally figured out what he is. Doesn't want to be with this girl anymore, so he's talking to the therapist to see how he could break the news to her, but at the end she ends up catching them, and I don't have all of that there yet, but you could play it. We'll see. There's some blanks where the therapist is supposed to be at, and I need a few more bugs to fit in, but hopefully it's understandable.
Excellent.
Yeah, and some of the clips, there's not going to be sound because I haven't put it. That's when he meets the therapist and flashback.
So, there you go.
Therapist again.
Ready? No. No.
That's it.
Comments, suggestions, and our leads to shooting tonight, right? 5 o'clock?
Are you shooting therapist sessions now?
Yes.
You need to use the old library. Did you get the couch? All right, we'll talk later. We'll get you the couch. Any suggestions, comments? Come on, this is your moment. Sebastian, I see half a hand.
Well, once it said suggestion or comment, it kind of messed me up. No, I'm just kidding. I like it, actually. I like it a lot. That moment where he says that text changes everything. Where
yeah, because that's when he doesn't feel the same for her anymore. And you can see it, like, in his face expressions, like, he's looking at her like, what the hell is she doing? Like,
I
go.
I just have one question. Mm-hmm. The moment that happens just before that, is that going to be the one where they're like enjoying the movie in the beginning? Are you gonna
In the beginning that they're enjoying the movie is like a whole lovey-dovey movie and he's into her. That's a flashback actually.
Right.
And then the next clip that comes in is when he doesn't like her anymore and he just feels uncomfortable towards her.
They're not gonna be together though, right? They're gonna be separated?
Yeah, there's gonna be something there.
That was my only question.
Does when you put the psychiatrist in, like, does that scene happen after or before the psychiatrist?
When I bring in the psychiatrist, like in the beginning, as you saw, that he's debating to see if he even wants to go to see the therapist. Mm-hmm. So he finally makes a choice and he goes, and that's when she comes in. But I'm not trying to show too much that she's a therapist. It's just like, oh, he's going to see a friend, probably. For yeah, it'll probably seem like, oh, he's cheating on her with another girl, but there's gonna be, at the end, it's gonna be revealed that you're gonna see the diploma, and he goes, thank you, these have been great sessions, you know, you helped me out a lot.
That last scene where he's sending a text, is that before he goes to see this?
No, this is, no, actually, that is after he sees her. That's after, and that he's texting the boyfriend, which that's why it's unknown and everything.
Okay, there's a lot of holes missing.
Yeah.
But just a little segue here. Sebastian, you're going to be meeting with Darlene before she shoots, because we really need her elevator pitch for the poster. By the way, John, we're making a poster.
My pitch is, what can you do when there's no glue? That's why it's called No Glue.
Okay.
What can you do when a relationship doesn't work anymore, like the glue isn't there anymore to keep it, to keep you out of
the go. That's good.
Very good. Good.
So,
round of applause. Great t-shirts we can sell at the film festival. No glue, no shoe. Okay, who's next?
I don't have
Leroy,
a movie,
no.
But can I still?
Okay, you go. But right now we're gonna do anything that's booted up. Edgar, you're next. Take the seat. Edgar, introduce yourself to John.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet
Take
you.
Take a seat.
Nice to meet you.
Good to meet you, Edgar.
Two things. I prepared something good, but second thing, I couldn't bring it.
Okay, so we're just gonna hear the pitch.
Right then. Imagine you lose everything in your life and. All right. Imagine you lose everything in your life and the only escape you have in your pocket is debt, but when that doesn't work, what can you do? So that's one of my points. Second point. But it's still, I bring the last footage I bring last time and the color corrected
one. Do we have that?
Yeah,
let's look at that. Let John see it and then we'll make some comments. Okay, we're ready.
Which one of the three? Which one is this one? You're gonna, Ricardo, which one is that one? The color corrected?
That's the, yeah, the whole thing, the 3-minute thing.
All right then.
Yes, no, something else?
I have three. Choose your destiny.
Thank you. Walk us through, Edgar, if there's no audience.
Yeah, and no, just kidding. What happened here is that I've been working the audio, and I have everything done already. But I was rendering, I spent 6 hours rendering. When I check out the format, it was animation, no X264 or nothing like that, so I couldn't play it back.
Okay, you have until Monday.
Oh, okay.
Feedback for Edgar. Come on, this is your time.
It's a narrative movie, that's why it's so silent right now.
It's what?
It's a narrative movie, that's why it's so silent right now.
Narrative movie with no sound, okay. Any other feedback for Edgar? Yes, Sebastian.
I really love when, the character's looking at himself doing those things. That's beautiful. I love that.
I like the tone of it, obviously it's kind of close to the bone of your personality, and I think that's really great, which is nice, it's sort of...
Well, Edgar's told us from day one he's an insomniac, he gets no sleep, and he wants to kill himself, but he's happy being a BCC student and wants to get a degree and travel the world, so he's got a big challenge ahead of him.
Yep.
We'll see your footage next week.
Yes.
Round of applause again.
Explosion already.
Don't worry, you'll have time. You have 28 days.
It's looking good.
Okay, who's next? Volunteer before we select someone. Do we have any more footage to see? Ariella, Andreas, no one? Okay. Leroy, up front.
How you doing?
I'm John.
You're on.
All right. I had a rough morning this morning, and I actually left a hard drive with my film on it. So, but the story is about a Latino man comes home. The story is called Apparition. An apparition is about a Latino man that has bad dreams, and he gets caught up between whether they're real or not. And how it starts off, has a conversation with his girlfriend. They're Latino, so they like to burn the candles before they go to sleep. He goes to sleep, he has a bad dream. He thinks he's awake, he sees a demon. The candle is out. He thinks he's awake again. Phone rings and the candle is on again. It's lit again. So, that's what I'm playing with, the whole dream thing. It's not really long, like 3.5 minutes, right to the point, in and out.
And what is it he want to express with this?
Horror. A horror piece. Because I have two demons that I designed, which Edgar helped me. I have a female heroine, it's an apparition as well, that saves him, so.
Nice. Sounds very provocative.
So, that's pretty much it. I wish I had the footage.
We've seen some of your footage, and you're working on it. You have a lot of special effects.
Yeah, actually, no. Actually, I had decided to do I decided to do it one way, but when we were shooting it, we actually, some other things happened. So it really won't be that much. I think it's gonna be more work on doing the audio and the music than
special effects. And this is interesting, what we were talking about earlier.
You have to go back to what
it's, what you intend to do sometimes doesn't work out the way you want it.
Right.
You got a little what you have. We always talk, John, about how a lot of our filmmakers, a week before the festival, they show their fine cut and they go, what you're about to see is not what I really wanted to make. But they try to tell us what their film was before they made it, and it's not there.
It actually turned out to be better, and the scene became darker, so... Instead of doing the special effects on a person, like we used Edgar, and he was obscure. He had a black hoodie on, and he was obscure, and he was out of focus. And there's a point where he reaches for my main character, and he's like, the hand comes in focus. So he steps up, everything is out of focus, it's black, and he reaches into the camera and the hand comes in focus. So that's actually better than putting special effects on going after effects and making it crazy.
Well, I also think that, the idea that making a film is a bit of a journey that ends you in a place different than where you started.
Right.
It's kind of the point.
Right.
What I mean? If you could kind of figure it all out and then you just did it and that was it, we'd be like, whatever. But you get into it and things happen to you. And I think that's very important. I think that's part of the, you know, that's part of the joy of it and part of the terror of it and just what it's all about.
Yeah.
So you said that earlier, which you have when you're done shooting, that's your new script.
And then it, you know, it's this evolution, and then it's, it takes you to someplace new that you, and if, you know, there were also times I've worked on films, you know, feature films that I had very strong ideas about what they were about and so on and so forth, and literally would have an epiphany 2 years later after the film was released, and I go like, well, that's what it was about. And it's like, I kid you not, and I've talked to other directors, and it happens all the time. It happens all the time, just because there are layers of understanding.
Right.
You know, it doesn't mean that what I understood when I was doing it was invalid, or it just, as you go through it, as you're experiencing, you get layers of understanding. And, you know, in some ways that's the difference between, say, working on a TV show where you're doing it in 3 or 4 weeks versus a movie where you might be working for a year. You know, there's a process that you go through in which you cogitate on this, you think about it, you digest it in different ways, and you come out someplace different, and then do that again and come out someplace different, and then go back. I was just, there's a Polish, famous Polish filmmaker who died about 10 years ago named Krzysztof Kieslowski, I don't know, and he made a series of 3 films based on the French flag, Red, White, and Blue. And they're 3 really great films, if you guys ever have a chance, or if you haven't seen them. And they were talking about the third, I just saw the third one again recently, and there were some liner notes in the DVD. And basically he said that there were so many choices that he had that he and his editor sat down and actually contemplated counting the number of theaters in France where the film was going to be released and making a different version for each theater. They rejected the idea, but it was there for a while. And then they cut, I think, 4 very different versions of the film. And then that taught them something, and then they went back to the original version, but with all that knowledge. And that often happens in editing. I always find that when I cut something, you put everything in, and then you're like, well, it doesn't work, and there's too much stuff. There must be a movie in there. And then I cut it, say it's a, let's just say it's a 2-hour movie. I'll cut like a 80-minute movie out of it. And it'll be like, just exactly what has to be in there. And then you say, oh, that's the line. Now I can start to fill it out a little bit. And then you start to put more stuff back in. And that process of putting everything in there and then saying, what is the most important line that you're figuring? And by line, I mean sort of the narrative thrust. What is agitating this story forward? You know, like, what is the dramatic idea that's moving forward? And then how can you trace it in the most, you know, sketchiest way with your footage? And until it's just there, and then you say, okay, well, then we need to know a little bit more about this character. We need to know, okay, so we'll put that scene back in. And then you start to put it back in based on the footage, and all of a sudden, you know, it has that arc, that through line that's sort of, you know, the spine of the piece, and then the pieces that you're adding all sort of come out of it. Because any good story really has like a tree, and then there are branches that come off of it. But if you don't understand what that tree is, at least on an intuitive level, then it's going to be a collection of, you know, bushes instead of a tree, if that makes sense. Anyway, so I think your process is a, you know, really good example of how that happens.
Yeah, thank you.
Sure.
Okay, I guess Aaron Waring is next. Come on up, Aaron. And again, you know, as we get older, things that were important to you now, they might not be important to you 5 years from now. Okay, Aaron. Say your name to the camera. Tell John what your film's about, and we'll look at a clip.
Aaron Waring. The title of my film is called Blue Deja Vu. And it's about a young man who's on a righteous path, but he's having deja vu mishaps, things going wrong in his life. And I actually just started filming this coming Saturday, at a restaurant that that's what Ossie helped me get. But I took a few pictures of some of the scenes in my movie.
Let's look at them, so and we can talk about that. Can we hit the lights?
So remember, this is deja vu of mishaps going on in his mind. So I wanted to have an ambulance right there where my guy gets injured. The sign of the avenue.
So this is sort of like your visual storyboard on how you see the picture, Aaron?
I mean, sort of, kind of, you know. I just wanted to really take pictures of the scenery where I'm gonna be at. You know, when he goes into a restaurant and the outside of it and the inside, of course.
You have a better sense than where to put the camera or cameras?
Of course, of course.
Are you shooting with one camera or two?
I'm gonna go with one camera, do it the old style, just move the camera around a lot.
Good for you.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's really it. I didn't want to not say nothing.
Okay, so I just want to, you know. John was location.
Yeah, it's funny because I have a film that I'm working on that I don't have the money for. I have some actors attached, and hopefully I'll do it in the fall. And, you know, just like I was talking about, that process of, you know, digesting and cogitating and thinking and so on and so forth. So, you know, I knew I was going to be in the Bronx today, so I just spent the morning driving around the Bronx, which is where this film takes place, thinking about, you know, looking at places. You know, it takes place in like a little Irish bar in a Hispanic neighborhood. And so we were just looking at Irish bars and Hispanic neighborhoods and so on and so forth. And, you know, it's not like I made a decision, it's going to be here, it's going to be there, but I have a bunch of pictures in my head. And in fact, as I watch your films and I look at the way different films have approached, you know, the visual kind of language, you know, and the images of the Bronx, I'm sort of taking all that in, you know. And that's one of the things that's really nice, because you think, like, when you're prepping your film, there's like a moment that you prep it, like, you know, you're going to shoot on Saturday, and so, you know, taking these pictures and so on and so forth. But actually, it's a long process,
yes,
you know what
yes.
I mean? And when you're in the midst of it's almost like everything that you see relates in some way, you know? It's like you take it all in, so.
And especially because I don't have a lot of dialogue. I'm moving my story forward with images, so. Taking pictures, going out and doing the whole work, it really helps.
And Aaron's a little modest. He's a wonderful photographer, videographer. Does a lot of things on spec just to show off his work. And he's a good writer. He's a good person.
Anyway,
very giving. He's helped many students in this class. And good luck this weekend.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay, anyone else want to pitch John? Come on up, Andreas.
How you doing, John?
Pleasure.
Professor, how you doing?
Good to see you.
Title of my 5-minute movie is My Bad. It's about a promiscuous girl. Then I explained to you earlier, a promiscuous situation going wrong. And the young lady, Rachel, she is very promiscuous. So she has her cake and she likes to eat it too. And she has lunch with her friends after coming from one of her partner's houses. And then in the midst of lunch, they get up to leave and they see her boyfriend with another female. And then a chase begins and then it's resolved at the end.
And tell John what restaurant you shot at.
Oh, we shot at Rue 57.
Is that right near the Directors Guild Theater?
Yeah, it's down the block.
57th Street. Yeah.
Yes, it's down the block from there.
It's a nice place.
Thank
cool.
you.
Cool, well, let's take a look.
Take a look.
More modern biker, not one of Hell's Angels. modern biker, whatever that means. Look, all I know is it was the worst experience of my life. His voice was deep, but his wife was much deeper. I just can't believe he left me after. I just can't believe he left me after all I did for him. I got him a job at the W, helped him improve his credit, all the walks in the ghetto, and he leaves me for his child's mother. Unfreaking believable! Freaking believable!
I'm surprised he didn't get to see the beach house.
He did. Yikes. He got the whole nine yards, plus a home run, and all you got was laid up. Heather, please, you've got to stop with the sports analogies. Instead of me watching this crap all day. But after, we go at it all night.
Ladies, listen, it's very simple. You have to be able to eat your cake and have it too. Just follow the dietary laws.
Can someone please educate me on these so-called dietary laws I'm meant to know about?
First, you
can someone please inform me of these so-called dietary laws I should be following?
First, you have to know what can be eaten and what can't be eaten. Second, you must know exactly how each meal is prepared. And lastly, you must know if it's kosher or if it's just for Passover. And lastly, you must know if it's kosher or if it's just for Passover.
Joel, you're sick. So, is this year-round or just seasonal?
You're thinking about it too much. Yes, I have Jamal. But I have my occasional slices of Italian, Albanian, or even Cuban.
Not to sound like a creep or anything, but can you fill me in? I need an exciting story. I need some new stories.
Okay, so this one time I met this guy, right?
Feedback for Andreas.
So, this was, you got it down to 5 minutes, right, to the end, right?
Yeah.
Did you work on the other part with, Rami?
Yeah, we did. It's coming together, looks really, really, concise, okay. I guess.
I like what you're doing.
Sebastian?
Hey, you're still making decisions on whether you're going to show their faces when they speak or whether you're going to, sort of the other end, from the other side, or?
Nah, I think we're up to just like putting it together, the puzzle pieces.
Did you redo your audio?
We got good enough audio.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
I was just asking because of, you know, I noticed at the end, you know, the repeat, so I wanted to know if you were choosing the one before or the one after.
Nah, that's a little bit of a rough cut,
yeah,
but
yeah,
so.
So you already made those decisions.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Ian, you had a question?
Yeah, in the cutaways, mm-hmm. during the dialogue opening scene. Remember, I think you mentioned that last time when you showed the rough cut. Did you want to do some cutaways?
It was a little cutaways that that's what we're going through right now. Okay. How we're gonna cut away and cut back to the story and stuff like that.
You know, John, just to segue into that, I remember since we were talking about Arthur Penn and Four Friends, one day you guys needed some sounds like at a ballpark or whatever. What type of ADR work for someone like Andreas? How important is it? Because he tried shooting in a very busy, you know, afternoon restaurant, New York City, a lot of cars, how important is it if he takes the actresses back into our Pro Tools room and redubs some of their audio? You could talk a little bit about what you go through in television shooting on location and busy, loud streets.
You know, it used to be worse than it is. I mean, even listening to your dialogue, there wasn't anything in there that I couldn't understand. And I think that once you EQ that, once you smooth it out, then put in some tracks so that even, you know, some background tracks that will be continuous so it evens it all out, I think you'll be fine. There may be a word or two here that you'll have to pull out of it. But, you know, I think, if it's a scene in which you can see that it's an exterior and it's a noisy place, then as long as people can understand it, they go with it. I think the problems where you really run into it is when you're in a quiet space where you don't see the traffic and whatever, and then or there's noise. Right. Like if we were having this conversation and there was some, you know, or a classroom next door and someone was practicing their scales on the piano or something like that, it'd just be really irritating. It would come and go and so on and so forth. But, you know, if you can grab some sound from one of the takes when no one's speaking, that will give you, you know,
some
create
room
a, some room tone and loop and work it through, I think you should be okay. But it's interesting to watch your editing process because, so what you're bringing up, which is, you know, you're trying to find the rhythms. Then as you get the rhythms, you know, you will start to, you know, hone it down a little bit for the overlaps and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, some of those may be technically driven because it's like the sound is better in that take, or it may be that it'll be driven, you know, by performance. And, you know, you kind of pick your way through that, and that's totally natural. And then feel free once you get to the end of that process to change your mind.
Okay.
I mean, it always happens. Right. It always happens. And you know, just like we're talking about, you have the script, and then you have the dailies, and the dailies have to speak back to you. Once you cut the dailies and you think, oh, that looks pretty good, then you wake up the next morning or a week later and you go, you know, you live with it a little bit and it keeps changing. And, you know, one of the tricks is to know when to stop. You know what I mean? And usually you have a pretty good sense of that. But it's also very beautifully done. Was that shot also with a 5D?
No, it was 6D.
How many cameras were rolling?
It was, at that scene, was two cameras. And then we brought out, like, a third camera, I think, for, like, for the chase scene.
Okay, the two cameras in the restaurant.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, that will help you with the sound, too, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Round of
well
applause.
Done, yeah.
Okay, so we have another film. Okay, so here's what I want to do. John, can we go to your reel? Because I really want John to leave you with one of the scenes that he's very proud of, because it's on his reel. And I'm hoping
Hi, how are you doing here?
It can transfer to your own work that you're going to be shooting in the next few weeks. Is there a scene, John, that we probably only have time for two more clips?
Let's do a really, really simple scene, which is, do you have the, can you put up the menu for a second? It's this one that says Signs of Life?
Yeah, the last one.
Turn the lights down. Just...
Yeah, the last one. Yeah, the last one. This is...
Let's just pause it for a second.
I'll set it up for you just a little bit. So this is a scene out of a movie that was made some years ago, and it's about a small town in Maine, and all the main characters work at a boatyard that builds wooden fishing boats, and nobody wants them anymore, and they're just launching the last boat. And in the course of this kind of magical day, they have to figure out what they're going to do with the rest of their lives, because they no longer have a job. It'd be like if we all worked at the school and the school is closing, what are we going to do next? And, you know, it repercusses in terms of, you know, their families, their relationships, their brothers, their siblings, and so on and so forth. So this is a scene, it's as simple as could be from a cinematic point of view, but it's something worth talking about because I think that if we look at something like, you know, that scene from Elementary, it's fancy schmancy. And so let's look at something we could just talk about. Here's like the basics, and then we'll just talk about that, why this is an interesting scene.
Hello, Rudy.
What can I do for you, John?
Oh, I need,
Yes?
What I mean is, I know you and I in the past, we haven't seen eye to eye. But, I need, Mary Beth and I need a job.
Mary Beth wants to work here?
No, Mary Beth and I. Job's for me.
You need a job?
Yeah, could you give me a job?
Maybe, maybe not. Depends.
On what?
On you.
On me.
I don't know what kind of worker you are.
Ernie, I've known you for 20 years.
Why do you want to work for me?
I'm flat on my back. I'm broke.
Want to be a salesman?
Anything. I don't care.
Do you know what that means, to be a salesman for pure thrift?
I'd sell things.
You don't just walk in and become a pure thrift salesman like that. First, you have to apply. Then you have to get somebody who's already in pure thrift to sponsor you. want me to sponsor you? If the main office in Wichita gives you the okay, then you have to go to the Pure Thrift Salesman Center and take the Pure Thrift Oath. Then and only then do you get to wear one of these. Of course, the one you'd be wearing would be green, signifying a salesman in training, but who knows, John? Someday you might get to wear the black hat of a full distributor. Two more good years and I'll be wearing a red hat. Senior distributor. I've got some applications in the back. Want me to get you one?
That's it.
Powerful scene.
Yeah.
Any questions?
Yes.
Address.
The Zoom. I noticed you used the Zoom a couple of times.
Dahlia.
Well, Dahlia. Well, yeah, that's in the intro, but as like it was like a slight zoom over the shoulder.
No, Dahlia.
Oh yeah, the Dahlia. I'm sorry.
No, they were both Dahlias.
Were you using that to like show some type of realization, or was it just for the purpose of?
Well, think of it this way. Every scene, always, no matter how short it is or how long it is, has a beginning and a middle and an end. And I think that's very important when you're telling a story. And so that scene had a beginning where he comes in and asks for a job, and he thinks it's going to be one thing. And then it has a middle in which he realizes it's going to be something else. And then it has an end, in which we have a surprise, which is all of a sudden, because he didn't go in there to steal the money, he sees that opportunity, he takes it, which has enormous repercussions, which are also very unexpected. So when I staged the scene, I wanted it to be very simple, but I also wanted to make clear that there was a beginning and a middle to the end that you would feel intuitively, not obviously. And so if you were to look at that scene again, the first gesture of the scene is just the cuts back and forth. And then when we get into the second part, when he realizes that this guy, you know, has another agenda, there's an issue of humiliation and power play and so on and so forth, that's kind of the middle of the scene as we're essentially coming into Bo Bridges' sort of consciousness. And then when he steps back and the guy leaves, you go wide again. And then we have another set of shots that are similar but a little different, and that's the third act of the scene. So that was sort of the way, you know, and it also, it heightens that moment just a little bit. And you see we put in a very gentle music cue that's sort of related to the theme of the piece. So that was sort of the way that scene was shaped.
Yeah, I when you dollied in at the part where he was explaining what it really would entail to get a job as a thrillerman working in, and it's like kind of like the world was closing in on him even more. But,
and that's the nice, when you have a moment like that and then you play it like that, you know, it's then open to interpretations, you know what I mean? It was like, I was like, oh, this is an important moment, so let's put a little zoom in there, and then you see it and you go like, you know, the first time the guy does it, he zooms at the wrong place and you're like, it's just gonna, you know, and that's where you have a good cameraman, you know, who just feels the speed and the, you know, and so. I once worked with a dolly grip who had worked with Martin Scorsese. And I said, okay, we're doing this scene. It was just like this. I want to push in like that, right? And he goes, well, what kind of push do you want? And I said, what do you mean? Just a push. And he goes, well, I got a lot of them.
Yeah, a bag of them.
And, you know, they were all very emotional in different ways, a little faster, yeah. Slower, a little slower, then fast, yeah. A little bit of a hook to it, whatever.
I guess they're saying in film, less is more. You know, this over-the-shoulder two-shot, it was just the actors and the simple shots that made it. Great. I mean, I loved it, you know, less is more.
Right, well, that's what I'm saying, rather than, you know, there are scenes on there that, you know, I'm putting on my reel because I want them to show the razzle dazzle, but sometimes just a very, very simple thing, you know, from a, from, But it's not really that simple. As you see, the scene actually has a lot, it has parts to it and moving parts. And,
right.
you know, so it appears simple, but actually, you know, it's been thought through. And that's sort of what I was saying with you guys, which is that, you know, a lot of the razzle-dazzle isn't what's going to get them. It's keeping it very simple and then finding those little things, those little moments that will help attenuate a moment and help tell your story.
John, can we see one more scene? We have time for one more scene.
Okay, let's do something different.
Law and Order.
That's a long scene. Let's not do that one. Elementary, Law and Order.
I have two questions for Jason.
Oh,
sure. You can do the questions before we.
No, after we.
See the next one. I'm looking at Thief. Is Thief on there? It must be, because it was at the end of that clip.
Oh, go to the next, the arrow.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Take the Thief clip. It's very different, but it's worth looking at.
Hey, what's going on, man? Still in my backyard.
I didn't let you down. Come on, man. I do my job, you know. I was exactly what I was supposed to do. I made a mistake. I get us in, and I get us out. That's what I do. That's my job. You count on me. You know what I mean? And whatever this asshole's, whatever he's saying, is bullshit, because...
This is a really bad time, man. Okay?
Come on, man.
Is it...
What am I going to do?
Look, I told you. Your shit has become our shit. I can't have that. Okay? We talked about it. You know, I tried, brother. It's over.
I do my job, and you know...
Bullshit.
Shut up!
Listen, I'm on control. Keep your voice down, brother.
Listen, man, come on.
Keep your voice down.
Well, come on, man. I do... Listen, man, I do my job. I always...
Why you been talking to this crackhead? Look at her.
Man, just... Look, I always do my job. You know my...
Dick, keep your voice down, man. We're gonna handle our business or what? Not in my back.
Are we gonna handle it?
Not in my back. Dick.
Okay. Come on.
Hospitals are gonna mean police. Get his gun, whatever else, put him in his car, get him out of here.
Take him where?
You know what to do.
I think she saw.
Go, go, go. We have to pull together.
as a family. Okay.
I just want to go to sleep.
That's it.
Perfect.
Well, a different being.
Yeah, very intense.
Very.
That was good.
Questions?
Parallel. Oh, actually. Yeah. I wanted to ask you two questions. The your company Talking Wall Pictures. I wanted to ask you the significance behind the name and also what inspires you as a director.
I don't remember the name. why we came up with that name, you know.
Had it for a long time.
Talking Wall, yeah, just sort of what it sounds like. You know, what inspires me as a director? You mean in the moment or in terms of a career choice?
In the moment.
It's interesting, the question I had earlier, when working in Hollywood independent film, what do you like the best, you know, as a director? Where do you like...
Okay, I'll answer that. I'll answer that and bring us back to that clip that we just saw, because that was the end of a pilot episode for that series, Thief. And essentially, I forgot to set it up, but Andre Brower plays a thief, but he keeps it from his family. He's married to this white woman and has a white stepdaughter. It's in the South. She's quite racist, and the wife gets killed, not by any fault of his, and essentially he's left to care for this stepdaughter. And this is a scene in which she discovers her stepfather, who she doesn't like anyway, and has very ambivalent feelings about having a black stepfather, now is quite a bit more than she thought he was. And so there's that moment where, you know, after the shooting takes place, that, you know, the guy says to him, I think she saw it. And then he comes in the kitchen, and there's just this moment of him thinking, and he's got to think to himself, well, do I have to kill her now? Because if she saw that, then she's, you know, in that position. So he has to come into that scene by the bed, and there has to be an understanding, an agreement between the two of them, that he has to figure out, did she see it? And if she did see it, what is going to happen? How are we going to play this? And then depending on how that happens, then he will act accordingly. So the guy who wrote the script, what I just described, kind of like, he goes, yeah, but it was all a little bit like hard for him to deal with. It was like we were going faster. And Andre Brower is an amazing actor, and he can articulate things in quite a lot of depth. And so what we did is we sat and we rehearsed that scene, and we talked about the moments, and we figured out the moment-to-moment work. Like when he touches her and she pulls back, that's like the moment that you realize that he realizes that she saw it. And then he says, we're going to be like a family.
A reaction.
Yeah, exactly. He knows that something's up, and it's got to be that. And then he says, we got to be like a family. And she says almost nothing. She says, I just want to go to bed now, or whatever. And then he leaves her. And there's an implicit understanding that this will not be discussed again. So all that had to happen with essentially no dialogue. So each one of those beats had to be crystal clear. The actors had to understand it, and then they had to play it. So in rehearsing it and then playing it, I think every beat is there. I don't think you're ever confused about what's going on in that. And it's very moving as well. And you understand both their points of view. That's what turns me on as a director.
Great answer.
Round of applause.
Ian is also the president of the BCC Mediatek and Film Society. He has a little gift for you. And if everyone
can
come up, especially we're going to take a group picture.
Okay.
Professor, I'm going to be in the picture.
Absolutely. It's Fernando or Jennifer.
No.
You stay in the picture. Okay. We'll give John the slate.
Oh.
Everyone come on up.
Look at that. Wow.
Come on, there's some cool stuff in there as well.
So we have to take this off so it doesn't kick.
Yeah.
Right?
Everyone in.